We have been called to live a sacrificial life. And we have been called specifically to be priests. Peter gives us the point of the priesthood. And it is one, the royal priesthood, and then two, the holy priesthood. Holy priesthood is basically your intercession and your connection with God direct, involving no man, where you bow before God. The Bible, the word the Bible uses is proskuneo. You bow and kiss at his feet, just between you and him. And then when you have done that, he instructs you, gives you direction as to how to lead your life, your day-to-day living, the people you interact with, the people you connect with, and that becomes your royal priesthood. That is also worship. And Paul, giving us his position on the text when he wrote to the Roman church, made us understand that when you have proskuneoed, you also need to lateria, which is another translation for worship. But this time, it is not the kind of worship that you stand before God, but it's the worship that you take instructions from God and you do it outside there, or even to other church people. And it gives us a very powerful ways of being effective royal priests. 7 points he gives us. Prophesying, serving, teaching, encouraging, giving, yeah, leadership, and mercy. We have looked at the 5 already, and today we're just going to finish up with the 6 and 7. If there's no time, we'll continue next week. We're not rushing anywhere. So let's look at the text again. Romans chapter 12, 1 to 3 and 6 to 10.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. Verse 6. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves.
Hallelujah. So he's saying that this is what we need to do when we walk in lateria. In other words, when we worship outside of the direct connection we have with God. It's important we know that God has set structures in life for us to enjoy. And we need to put those structures or understand those structures in order to take full advantage of life. There's too much wickedness out there. Satan is working very hard. He is very busy. I was telling somebody just this morning that we always flippantly say Satan is not powerful. Let me tell you something. He is powerful, but God is most powerful. Hallelujah. If you see some of the atrocities and the things that he's doing, that tells you the kind of leverage he has. But we thank God that his power cannot match God. We thank God that he sent Jesus Christ, and because of that, we are more than victors. Hallelujah. Amen. You never underestimate your opponent. You never, I repeat, underestimate your opponent. Every boxer will study the fights of his opponent. They will get DVDs and CDs and stuff. Sometimes they even send their trainers to go and watch them fight other people and look at their weakness. They say that, well, his left side is weak, his left side is right side. In the same way, the war is over, but battles continue. Battles are raging. When all the allied forces and so on and so forth, Winston Churchill and the rest declared that Second World War was over, it took some time. Because even though the war was declared over, there were pockets of battles all over Europe. And the enemy does not give up. The Nazi guys, they did not give up because they know that they will have to face Tribuna and what they do when you go to illegal war and stuff like that. So they had to fight even though it's been declared. It's the same thing with the spirit. The devil knows his end. The devil knows that he has been judged, but he still has demons and principalities and so on and so forth that fight us. And so we should know our leverage. We should know our power. And most importantly, we should key into it. I was telling the church in Perkan today that you don't take things for granted. You got to pray. Even over your food. There's attack on our food. You must make the right choices. Not cheap food. And when the food is before you, don't make a cross on top of it. Some people make a cross on the soup. And some people say, blessed, bless. Hallelujah. Amen. The duties of the royal priest. It is out there that we make changes. It is out there that we effect lives. It is out there that the people Satan have held in their clutches. Let me tell you something. As a believer, whether you like it or not, you are in war. So you better accept it and start fighting. As soon as you declare your stand with Jesus, battles begin. You go to your workplace and because of your presence, some demonic forces cannot happen. You are a target. You declare certain things into somebody's life and you pray for the person and those people that want is done for and stuff. They turn on you. So you are always, and I'm not saying this to make you live in fear, God forbid. I'm just saying this to be aware that life is about war. It's about battles. And therefore, we should know how to conduct ourselves. That is your duty. The sixth and seventh one we're going to deal with now, and the first is leadership. It says that when we go out there, we must operate in leadership. Some of the things I'm going to say today is going to be hard, but please permit me to say the mind of God. The key to development and stability in any nation is leadership. Leadership determines whether a country moves on or a country doesn't. Leadership determines whether a household is put together properly or it doesn't. Because in life, people don't know what they want. Hallelujah. In life, I repeat, people don't know what they want. They are not even sure if they want what they have. When you study Saatchi and Saatchi and all those branding companies and stuff like that, they'll tell you that we have to tell people what they need, what they should want. And so you sit there and you have no appetite for Coca-Cola, even though it contains about 14 spoons of sugar and all the chemicals in there can kill you. And they tell you that that is what you want and that is what you should drink. So they bring a very macho hunk. Sweating. No, that's Pepsi, isn't it? I don't want you to be, that's Pepsi, yeah. So Pepsi, let's go to Pepsi. Let's go to Pepsi. So they say it's break time. And all the people the ladies in the workplace just run out there. And this hung, and the bottle or the can is sweating. Sweating. And you look at it. And they say, I've got to drink that. and you know it's poison to you, but you still, because they tell you what you'd have to get. It's leadership. Bible says that he who wins soul is wise. And I told you that that scripture has nothing to do directly with evangelism. It has to do with anybody who can win someone to their own persuasion. So it can be a political party. A Tory person convincing a Labour person to vote for them is wise. It can mean a Satanist convincing somebody to become a Satanist. That is leadership. Leadership is influence. Leadership is how you can get somebody to think the way you think. So they sit at the boardroom and they say that we need to sell about how many trucks of Coca-Cola or Pepsi or whatever, and they begin to think it through. They sit there and they say that we should do something about these children and sell them toys and stuff like that. And they say that children like colors. Let us decide what they like. So they come up with a funny images. Teletubbies. La La. Po. Dipsy. And which one, the other one? Tinky Winky. I'm not that Tinky Winky. Tinky Winky. And they bring you Tinky Winky, La La, Deep Sea, and Po. And then people are, you remember, people were queuing in Kapam or someplace like that. I mean, it was almost like a ma, because Tinky Winky was in shortage. Are you understanding that? And which one has the bag? Tinky Winky. And the Tinky Winky just takes the bag and it goes like that. And then your child also takes the bag and it goes like, hey, can I put the bag down? And it says, somebody's offering your child leadership, showing your child what you like. It started in the boardroom. May I tell you that God has sent us into the world to offer the world leadership. A lot of things that go on, I was telling someone, I said, we have ignored our children. We target adults. But adults' behaviors have already been formed. Try teaching an old dog new tricks. That's why we've been teaching you new tricks. You are not taking it. Because you're all old dogs. We preach it every day. But they don't do that. They don't target the adults. They target the children. Have you ever asked why you cook good food for your child and doesn't want to eat it? And you sit in the car and see McDonald's. McDonald's, mommy! Mommy, you're passing it! Mommy, mommy! You hear me? They know how to get to the children. They put toys in the thing. And you see a little crocodile. Plastic crocodile. In the stuff. He goes there and he gets the beggar. And as soon as he sees that thing, next time, he has to go there. And if you don't give him, he stays out there when another auntie is coming. Auntie, it was my birthday yesterday, you know. It was my birthday. Oh, really? What's your birthday? Yes. Well, I don't mind McDonald's. But he knows it's not allowed it. But he'll try. Somebody was giving someone toffee, and the mother came along. I'm not allowed that, auntie. I'm not allowed that. But the father says, oh, please, auntie. They know how. And so by the time your children grow up to a particular age, their tastes have been engineered by these people, their way of thinking. Now, even the last 2 weeks, they want to make sex education compulsory. It used to be optional. You can tell your children to opt out of it. Now they want to make it compulsory. We should fight it. You don't want any deviant teaching your child what sex is. You have done it all these years and you give birth to them. You have to teach the child yourself. I'm serious about it. But anyway, so they give them leadership. They train them at the childhood stage. And they pump ideas into them. But brothers and sisters, we are not in the world to just go and pray, because they don't understand that language. That language is an empowerment in the church. It's empowerment in our proskuneo. When we get out there, we should not go to their face. They will say you are mad. They will call some psychiatrists on you. But when you have been empowered in your closet, and you go there and you give leadership, there's something about your voice, there's something about your decisions, there's something about how you stand that they cannot ignore you. He says leadership. Leadership made nations grow. Leadership make companies thrive. You go to some of these companies that are listed on the stock exchange, especially the 100 index FTSE, and you realize that most of these top guys, they are headhunted because they offer leadership. If you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. Hallelujah. If you don't know where you have come from, you know where you are, and we know where you're going, nobody can throw you left and right. They cannot make you yo-yo because you know your God. Hallelujah. Some of you are always looking for latest fashion so you can join in. Own fashion. I had only 5 people. Hallelujah. You got to understand in life, leadership starts with you. You should not be moved by media. Oh, yes, we have brought a new thing now. Everybody's wearing tights. But I've got chunky legs. So the tight is not for me. I will wear something that when somebody looks at it, he will say, wow. And that is not conventional. It's me. Leadership is you. You look at yourself. You look at the color of your skin. You look at what you like. You look at everything about you, and you begin to put things or structures in place that really stamps God's glory on your life. We are all not the same. Look at these fingers. Some are thick. Some are slim. Some are taller. Some are short. We all not different. We are all not the same. We are different. And because we are not the same, you have to be able to evaluate where you have come from. Evaluate where you are. Evaluate where you're going. Media is leading us. The church should be doing that. Teachers are leading us. The church should be doing that. Somebody sits down there and makes a decision and nobody can challenge it. And very soon, they'll be teaching your children things that is not consistent with their belief and their faith. Very soon, they will decide what we believe and what we don't believe. These are all prophetic because I'm not saying that's here the Lord. But when you preach and you teach, God speaks through the teaching and speaks through the preaching. I'm telling you something. Glory to God. I remember some time ago, I stood and I talked about Brexit and I said that UK is never going to leave the Brexit and all that because of the Asian Roman Empire. They started talking about that. Just yesterday, they said that it looks like they will have to come back. And it's going to happen because it's prophecy. You cannot run away from that. Are you hearing me? Now, who knows that there is a link to Africa? Because now, the British government is just going to look into creating free trade zones with a lot of Commonwealth nations. And you know what is going to happen? Once they create the free trade zones with those Commonwealth nations, money will be poured in there for structures to be put in place. So then every citizen can be accounted for. Now, when those things have happened and there is a smooth transition, who knows that the whole system will go back and link with Europe again. And once it links with Europe again, now everybody now is accounted for within the whole system. So it sets the pace for the Antichrist to come. So then you cannot run to Africa and get away from the whole system. Wherever you are, from Timbuktu to Dokotre to Ogbomosho to Navrongo, the Zambezi forest, you'll be located. I'm telling you. They have tested the chip, and they are successful with the chip, with cats and dogs. So now all the detail of a cat is in a chip, and it's set in there. When it's coming in, they just put a scanner, pew, and everything comes. When your dog is coming into the country, they just put it, pew, and everything comes. It's working. No, side effects. Now listen to what is going to happen next. We now have cards, isn't it? The world is going to be cashless society. Now, when you finish with cashless society, your card can be stolen. Your card can be stolen. Your wallet can be stolen. So they will tell you that, well, to be able to be very secured, you know what? Let's have a one card that have all your accounts and your details and your score. Instead of having 40 cards and stuff like that, you begin to have just one. And one has your social insurance number, everything. You go to Tesco's, you just have to go one, and everything just works it out. All right? Now, that one also can get missing. So let us find a way that we can secure it. So instead of putting the chip in a big card, let's just put the chip in your hand, on your forehead, somewhere. Where that one, if somebody had to steal it, they steal you. Someone, and there will be perfect, legitimate reason why it must be done. And you will love it. I mean, I love cashless society. I'm not sure about you. You know, when you do things that are, in fact, because you everything is direct debit because you don't want to miss out on your payments and stuff like that, so it's easy for you. And it will be very, very reasonable. Who doesn't want to just go to Tesco's and you do that, get pip, and then everything is paid for, and you walk away? It makes the world easy, and you are like that. But in so doing also, everybody is being lined up for the Antichrist. I mean, I will not be surprised if Jesus returns in our lifetime. Because things are getting so fast. And when you listen to the European news going on and so forth, but these are the people that give us leadership. That is why the church must rise. I mean, we cannot kick against prophecy. What God has said will be, it will be, regardless. However, the church must take its place of influence. And brothers and sisters, you and I know the church is not the building. The church is you. The church is me. And so we must put our place first. We must be well informed, number one. With that information, you cannot be a leader. We must be well informed. Now there's information superhighway. You don't need to own 50,000 volume of library in order for you to function properly. We call something Google. Wikipedia. All these things are available. You need to be informed. Today, you must have some idea about stuff. My wife went to the heart doctor to see our GP and was talking to our GP and said, I think this is what is wrong and stuff like that. And the GP said, how did you know that? He said, well, I checked on Google. He said, Google. Now, Dr. Google is taking my work from me. Doctor. He's a very funny doctor. Dr. Google is taking my work from me. So we started making jokes about Dr. Google taking my work and stuff like that. He was so going on and on. But the fact of the matter is that you go to the hospital and they tell you that you're suffering from so and so. You don't just come and sit down and cry. Find out what it is. Find out, read about it. Check it out. And then when you go before God in prayer, you pray in specifics. Hallelujah. Because I always tell you that there's facts and there's truth. The Bible talks about truth being Jesus. And facts be what we have. And as a matter of fact, what the doctors are saying might be the facts, yes. But there is also truth. And the Bible says that the truth is that what? By his stripes, I am healed. And I need to put it there, right there. We need leadership. Turn to somebody and say, we need leadership. Leadership will then bring you influence. Hallelujah. We have influence, brothers and sisters, but we don't use it. We have to use our influence in the marketplace. We have to use our influence in our work of places where we work and stuff like that. Some of you people adore you. They just love your style. How have you used that to bless them? When they give you compliments, just say, and walk away. I'm not saying that turn your offices into evangelism parlor. But the truth of the matter is that when you are out there, God somewhere, somehow puts a light on you. And there are certain people who just love you when you've not even done anything. Certain people, they stop for you. They open doors for you. How are you giving them leadership? These are all signs that God wants you to reach out to them. The same thing, if you tell somebody, somebody else will tell the same thing to that person and they will not believe. But when you tell them, they will believe. That is the influence God has given you over the persons.
It's very important. Anytime God brings somebody into your life that you need to influence, you must influence the person for the purposes of God. But it can only happen when you have influenced yourself, when you have worked in your own leadership. Because a lot of us don't know how to lead ourselves. And I'm going to give you some very disturbing examples. First, let's look at Moses. Let's read the text quickly. And then I'll give you those examples. And let's read Moses, Numbers 27 to 12.
The Lord said to Moses, take the staff, and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together. Speak to that rock before their eyes, and it will pour out its water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community so they and their livestock can drink. So Moses took the staff from the Lord's presence just as he commanded them. He and Aaron gathered the assembly together in front of the rock, and Moses said to them, listen, you rebels, must we bring you water out of this rock? Then Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out, and the community and their livestock drank. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I give them.
People who misuse their influence as a deliberate act to sway those they influence from God's purpose, stand in danger of a harsh judgment from God. I repeat, people who misuse their influence as a deliberate act to sway those they influence from God's purpose, stand in danger of a harsh judgment from God. And if Moses didn't escape that, don't let anybody think they will escape it. That is why those of us who are in royal priesthood must understand that leadership starts with us. I want to talk freely as a pastor. We have influence. If I told everybody, rise to your feet right now, you will rise. If I tell everybody, clap your hands right now, you will clap. That is influence. But let me tell you something. If I use that influence for my own selfish reasons, I stand in a harsh judgment. A lot of people have not realized that the glory God is giving them or blessed them with is not them. Listen, it would be wrong for the donkey Jesus sat on to Jerusalem to think that it's because of it that people are spreading their mat and their clothes. Jesus never walked on the mat. He never walked on the cloth. It was the donkey that did. It was the donkey that enjoyed the carpet, the red carpet treatment, because Jesus' feet was hanging in the air. It was the donkey that was walking on it. But if the donkey thought for a minute that people are really hailing me, and that is what we do in the church. The man or God respects you. Sorry, the people God has given to you in terms of influence, they respect you because you are the pastor. They respect you because you are the praise and worship leader. They respect you because you are the elder. But if you use that means to extort money from them, to sexually abuse them, to treat them any way evil, and a lot of them are gullible, a lot of them will not question you, but let me tell you something. Your end will be miserable. We have to come to a place where we understand that integrity is the foundation of true leadership. Hallelujah. You don't twist people. I mean, let me be honest with you. In fact, when God has poured anointing on you so much, even as a male pastor, you will have a lot of females throw themselves at you. You may be as ugly as a baboon. But when anointing comes on you, there is some way, somehow, the anointing negates the baboon look. I'm sorry, but I need to say this. And woe betide you if you think that it's because of you that you're getting all this attention. And so let me mess with somebody's daughter. Let me mess with somebody's wife. Let me mess with somebody's mother, and so on and so forth. Yes, they may give themselves to you because of the attraction of the anointing. But you pay so dearly for it. That is why a lot of us have lost our influence. Music ministers have lost their influence. Because instead of leading the choir, they led the women. Can I preach? Hallelujah. Pastors have lost their influence. Instead of leading the church, they led the ladies. Listen to me, church. Paul is saying that we have something to do out there. God will bring people your way. It's not because you're handsome or you're pretty. It's not because of your knowledge. Of course, God wrote on your handsomeness or your prettiness or your knowledge. But God is bringing those people into your life so you can influence them. Do you think that because you are so handsome, they just come to you and ask of your life? I have people come here, ask me questions. Sometimes they call me at the office and say, oh, pastor, I need you to help me. My colleague is saying this and that and that. And what do you tell the person? And I'll coach them what they need to do and stuff like that. That is influence. You didn't go evangelizing. They came to you. And then you sit them down and you say, this is the way I think you should deal with it. And some of them, they give feedback to me. And they say how wonderful the counsel was and how this person. That is influence. It's only one person that holds the microphone. But when you have heard what has been said, you then go out there and you also have your microphone in your world where you are. And then you use your microphone to influence people for God. There is a brother called Moses. Moses was a good guy, but unfortunately he messed up. I was so distraught when I read the text. Because when I read the text, I said that Moses had been so right and so good. God, why just this one mistake? It was too harsh. Look at what David did and other people did. And God showed me something that disturbed me as a pastor. Because pastors have influence. And this is what God said. He said, when I lift and I exhort you as a minister to deal with the souls of people, I expect you to always show my front to them. With all Moses did, I repeat, just one thing. God spoke to him. And he said, speak to the rock. Don't strike it. In Exodus, it was different. When he said, strike the rock. Here, he says, speak to it. The Bible says that Moses was so angry with the people. And he struck the rock twice. But look at what God says there. It says that Moses raised his arm and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out and the community and the livestock drank. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the people you influence, you will not bring this community into the land I give them. It says, will God bring a water from the rock? Take water. That is what he did. If I want to say it exactly how he did it, he was stammering. So this is how he did it. The Lord bring water for you to drink. You want water? Take water. Why did God do that? He said, because you undermine me in front of my own people. You did not make me big in their eyes. And a lot of times, you mark this space. Anytime God puts you in a place of influence, if you cannot handle it, tell God, I don't want to. Now I'm getting tough now. A father, is supposed to exhibit the true nature of God as a father. Because sons can never ever understand God unless they understand it through a father. And so as a father, if you make your children turn their back on God because you did not represent God to them, you are in danger of harsh treatment. As a leader, no matter your appetite, you must learn to lead yourself. It's quiet here. You must learn to do what? Lead yourself. I always talk about HATE. And HATE is the acronym for honesty, integrity, transparency, and truthfulness. That must undergird your purpose in life. Everybody once in a while will feel licentious. Everybody once in a while will feel to do something they shouldn't do. But at that moment, you employ the power of the Holy Spirit because the repercussions can be dire. People who rose to be somebodies just before they became somebodies because they compromised their integrity, they were brought down to grass. We love life, don't we? So Paul is telling us that when we go to the marketplace, we must display leadership. Let me just say a few more things and then we pray. Leadership is that which makes the church grow. I can't influence everybody. But the people I can influence, and the people you can influence, and the people you can influence, when they come together, the kingdom gets big. There's somebody, even if he needs next to FCI, he will never come to church in FCI. But there's somebody, if he lives even in Timbuktu, at some point we had members coming Sundays after Sundays from Telford and Birmingham to church. I don't even know they still do. We have members who come from Anfield and Outer Mongolia. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's not everybody I can influence. It's not everybody you can influence. I told somebody that there are certain people, the only people they can influence is prostitutes. Yes. They understand their language. They give them leadership. And because they understand their language, they are able to win them for Christ. They are not there to take advantage of them or pimp them. They are just there to help them. There are certain people that have influence in the ghetto. They don't know how to wear long gowns and suits and clerical collar and all those things. But they are just as effective. When they go to that ghetto, they don't speak the English that you speak after you've drank your tea and ate your salad. They speak broken English. They go to the theaters and say, Charlie, wait till they go on. I talk, you say, Jesus Day. Make one, I give one alive to Jesus. Wait till they talk about. Get cho, bring the cho. The cho is ready. Make we just cho and this and that. Are you hearing me? And they will pray over their food in broken English, in pidgin English. And that is okay. And people will give their life to Christ. Leadership. Glory to God. Hallelujah. There are certain people, I don't have patience for children. I'm honest, I don't. But there are certain people that, I mean, the children will follow them like ducks. Pastor Andy, for years, children ministry, God bless you for that. You don't see many men in that area. Hallelujah. And you see this guy, you go there with the children, and they all, Uncle Andy, and then things like that, Uncle Andy. Leadership. Literally, you tell these children, do whatever, and they will do it. They will not question it because they have your trust. Can you imagine then he having that responsibility over the children and leads them away from Christ? That is what Christ said. That anyone who leads any one of these astray, in other words, your leadership is there to ground people in God. May I tell you then that people gravitate to you not because of anything but because of God. It is not not a fluke or by chance that your boss likes you so much. In fact, if he's got even ulterior motives, just keep the ulterior motives at bay and deal with him. Seriously. You give the person leadership. I know somebody, this particular big guy, any decision he makes, he had to consult this small person. Leadership. I mean, the guy is bigger than him. But you have to consult. That's how it happens. In your car, in your workplace, places you go, people you interact with, God will bring them to you. And the whole idea is that you apply the grace he has placed on you to bring them to Christ. Sometimes you don't even have to mention Jesus from the beginning. You just befriend them. And they begin to read your life. They see how wonderful you are. They see how together you are. They see your integrity. They see how different you are. Have you ever been with some people and they will make a comment, and then if the comment concerns you, maybe if a black person is, black is, then you say to the person that, excuse me, I'm also black, and then you tell you that you are different. Or they make a comment about Christians, and then you say, but what are you talking about? I'm also a Christian. You are different. That tells you you have influenced them. And so anytime you now move the next level to tell them something about Christ, to tell them how to live, the kingdom expands. So if you influence 5 people, he influenced 10 people, she influenced 20 people, then you see the kingdom, it keeps expanding. Because we all look for different things in people. We look for different things in churches. That is why somebody will leave Welling and go all the way to somewhere in the south for church service, and somebody will leave somewhere in the north and come all the way to Welling. You cannot. I tell people all the time that we don't go to church because of Jesus. We become Christians because of Jesus. But we don't go to church because of Jesus. Understand that? If you don't understand it, let me break it down. If we go to church because of Jesus, next door to you, there's a church. Jesus is there. Why don't you go there? Hallelujah. You don't go to church. The church, kind of church you go, you are in the kingdom because of Jesus. Don't misunderstand me. But the choice of a particular church you go to is not because of Jesus. It's because of, maybe you like the pastor. Maybe you like the way they worship. Maybe you like the decor. Maybe you like the kind of people that go there. Maybe you like the philosophy that is perpetuated in the place. Something. So you drive miles and leave few churches around. And all these churches you're driving past, Jesus is equally there. But you don't choose that place. We call it influence and leadership. So in conclusion, God has stipulated or God has put in place certain people we should influence in our lives. Hallelujah. And when the people come into our life, may you get the discernment to know who they are and influence them right. I repeat, pastors, listen to me. When women are falling over your feet, people are coming all around you, don't think that it's because of you. It's the unction God has placed on you. And you must always, always direct them back to God. Church elder, begin to understand that when people are all over you and worshiping you, in quote, and stuff like that, don't think about it. Excuse me, you are a donkey. You are a big, fat donkey. Excuse the expression. But you are a donkey. Amen. It's not about you. It's about the person sitting on you. Glory to God. And members, when you go out there and your bosses celebrate you and your friends celebrate you and people look at how wonderful you are, again, know that you are just a donkey. Hallelujah. And God has made your path cross so that you can put one or two things in their lives. Anybody you influence, make sure that you direct them to God. God bless you. Shall we rise? The beauty about those you influence is also that they carry your gold, your myrrh, and your frankincense. That is the beauty about it. Have you ever heard somebody say that this person is not moved by anybody, but yet when it comes to you, it's different? Some people, they are cankerous. I don't know if it's an English word. They are very controversial. They fight everybody. But when they come to you, they behave themselves. They are close with you. Somebody will ask you, How can you be so close with such a person? And you say, I don't know. But it's the grace you carry. Hallelujah. I mean, there are people God has placed in your sphere of influence that you need to turn them to God. Don't ever think, I repeat, a lot of times, you know what we do? When people gain our trust in church, and we need to destroy the pastor to them, destroy the members to them, in fact, even destroy the church to them, and they think they go scot-free. Oh, no. Somebody used their house as a headquarters for gossip. And it came to my knowledge, and I warned them that you are not fighting the church. You are fighting God. So stop it. They didn't stop it. The house was repossessed. And I said, they've not finished. They've repossessed the land and every account and everything as well. You have to understand some things. Moses' one shook me. He says, I am not letting you inherit because, he said very clearly, you destroy the people by projecting me wrongly to them. And I'm sure Moses had to deal with his anger. Somebody who could part the Red Sea. Listen to this, part the Red Sea. Somebody who could see fire in a bush. Someone who could put a stick down and it changes to serpent and it picks it up and it becomes a stick. How can God not just touch his lips? A miracle of speaking right and a stick turning into a serpent. Which one is difficult to do? Which one is difficult to do? But God is saying that there are certain things you got to deal with it yourself. So we're going to pray, Lord God, give me leadership. I want to be able to lead me. And leading me means discipline. Leading me means no to things that will cause a great defect to what I stand for in God. Because I can prophesy to you that in the next few days, leadership will cause you to rise to another level. I am seeing, I don't want to resist. I am seeing a lot of us, FCI members, taking top positions in this city. Because integrity is riding on the glory God is giving us. And we are coming in contact with people of reverence that is causing greatness to come upon us for his purpose. Some of you are going to be promoted for no reason. I'm saying it and mark it. It's going to happen when it comes. Come and give the testimony. You know the prophet is right. Some of you are going to be promoted for no reason. It will not be because they did an appraiser and appraiser was right. It's just because your boss will walk to you and they said that there's a post available. Would you want to take it? And all you say that I'm ready to take it with a pay increase in the name of Jesus. Integrity has a way of promoting. Integrity has a way of causing you to ride in your high places. And you know something? You always have a free heart. Because no matter who God brings your way, you are not there to take advantage of them. You are not there to take advantage of them. Somebody walked to me in my office and he said something. My heart just jumped and I started praying. I said, Lord God, because what she said, I can see that if she had gone to any other prophet, I'm not saying perfect, I'm not. But I said, this is a recipe for abuse. Some of us, we are so trusting. But that is why anybody that comes to you that is that level, the first thing you say is, God, how can I influence her for your glory? And certainly God will show you. Lift up your voice and just pray right now. Just talk to God for a few minutes about leadership. Maybe God willing in the future we'll take it as a topic and deal with it. But we're looking at leadership in the context of royal priesthood. It's a key leadership. Influence. Just talk to the Lord right now. In the name of Jesus. There are people around you that you influence so much, but you don't know what to do with them, come to the altar and pray with you right now. I'm praying a revelation for you that God will direct you on what to do with them. There are people around, it could be your workplace, it could be your family, but there are people around, they eat the words. They literally eat the words you say. I mean, you tell them go, they go, come, they come, but you don't know what to do with them. Let me tell you something, God brought them your way for a purpose. And if that purpose has not been discovered, I want to stand with you in prayer in the next 2 minutes, right now. In the name of Jesus, walk to me at the altar. And just as you come to the altar, pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word. Fill us. Give us, Lord Jesus, deeper insights of influence and leadership. We want to inherit our promised land, unlike Moses. So show us what to do that will not err against you. We bless you, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our mission is raising overcomers, setting the captives free. Freedom Center International is here to support you in every step that you take with the Word of God as you seek spiritual and emotional wholeness. And we hope you've been blessed by today's message. Worship with us at 38 Upper Wickham Lane, Welling, Kent, DA16 3HF, or give us a call on 0207-277-8700. You can also visit us online at fcichapel.org. And remember, there is progress in freedom.